is Rod Santamassimo with the Massimo Show. And I know every week I say I have a special guest. Well, this time I'm going to blow you away. Well, I'm not. My guest is going to blow you away because it is the one and the only Mr. Kevin Harrington. Now, for those two of you who have no idea who Kevin is, I'll be really brief here, Kevin. You've been a successful entrepreneur for over 40 years. You are one of the original members of the amazing show Shark Tank. In fact, you did about 175 episodes with them. You are the inventor of the infomercial, the As Seen on TV pioneer. You're the co-founder of the Electronic Retailers Association and co-founding member of the Entrepreneurs Organization. And listen to this, folks. Kevin has launched 20, that's 20, individual businesses that have sales over $100 million. And last but not least, if that doesn't get you, Entrepreneur Magazine has called him one of the top entrepreneurs of our time. Kevin, we are honored. We are absolutely honored. Welcome to the Massimo Show.
Hey, buddy. Great to be here. You could keep talking. I like that. That's a great opening.
Well, look, I appreciate, I know your time is valuable. I see that COVID shadow coming in. You know, I know you're a busy guy, but let's get right to it.
Never had a beard until now, right?
Kevin, if I start growing one 20 years ago, I still wouldn't have one. So I'm jealous. So here's how it goes. We always start with beginning and all our guests, whether it be Tom Ziegler or some people you know, Lorraine Langmeyer, Laurel Langmeyer, all these folks, Waldo, you know. So we want to start with the beginning. And for you, your beginning is a little different. So we always ask the question, what were you doing in high school? Where were you? And what were your passions? Let's hear it.
Great question. Thanks, Rod. Appreciate it. So just real quick, grew up in Cincinnati, Ohio. My dad was a bartender and he saved up enough money. I was one of six. I went to an all boys Catholic high school. So you talked about high school. And my dad said, he was going to save up money to open up his own business. And he opened up Harrington's Irish Pub. So now at 11 years old, I was in there working side by side with my dad. It was a small restaurant also. And so they were doing wings and food and bar and drinks. And after a couple of years of doing this, working 40 hours a week, and making a dollar an hour, I said to my dad, I know this is a great little business for you, but where do I get to start making money, right? He said, you have to make money. Other than hourly, you got to own your own business. So I went out and started, 15 years old, a driveway sealing business and, coating the asphalt, right? Seal the cracks, beautify the driveway, knocking on doors. I take a picture before and after, and I called it a magical transformation. So I would knock on a door and they'd say they're busy, they don't have any time, and I'd say, well, hey, you see the one across the street? Here's the before, here's the after. When you get time, I can come back and show you how I can do that for you. And they're like, well, wait a minute, you're here now, come on in, so I'm selling 10 a week at the age of 15. And then I sold them, and then I did the installation also, because it was just a squeegee on the driveway, and I had a little training from the manufacturer. But I was a independent sole proprietor entrepreneur doing this on my own. Then I got to college, and I said, well, my dad's like, well, look, you're the fourth of six kids. Your older sisters, they got their college paid for. It's now your turn to go to college, but you're going to be paying for your own college. Like every time my dad sat me down, it was like going to be some bad news or something, right? But I had my tuition, my books, my apartment, my insurance, my car. I had to have everything full sphere to go to college. So I said, I can't do this with just doing a few driveways and more than a few, but quite a few in the summer, because that was strictly a summer business. I said, I need something year round. I said, what's year round? Heating and air conditioning. So I started a heating, ventilating, and air conditioning company. And I started the business from zero and went straight out. I was using contractors to do the installation, but I went to the courthouse and received a list of every new homeowner transaction, new home sold in Cincinnati, Ohio. And this is back in the 70s. Okay, so I'm talking 1976, 77, 78. I was getting all the new homeowner transactions, and we would call them and offer them a free safety check of their furnace and a furnace cleaning. And then we would also have an opportunity to talk to them about buying something. So this is how we started our business. We went from zero to 1 million in sales in our first year. At the end of a year, I was a sophomore in college with 25 employees doing $1 million in business and five or six trucks going out every single day. And I was going to college still. So I only could do that for a little while. By the time I got to the end of my sophomore year and I was going into my junior year, I had to drop out of college. I just couldn't run that business. I mean, that's the equivalent of a $5 million business. And I was 18 years old. So
let me take you back, because some people are wondering, wait a minute. When you're 15 and you start in the driveway business, how did you, did it come natural to you that you understood the transformation language and story and that's what would sell? Were you reading books to tell you that's how you sell? How did you know to craft your story that way to get the business?
So I learned it because the very first day that I went out into a neighborhood, I had an older sister, and she says, all the driveways in my neighborhood could use this. Why don't you come out and start in my neighborhood? So I did, and I knocked on 20 doors, and I got 20 very nice people that told me no. Okay, because I think they looked at me and thought, Who are you? Are you going to be able to do this, right? Well, so then I get back to my sister and I said, boy, you got a lot of nice neighbors, but nobody wants to do it. And so my brother-in-law said, tell you what, do ours now. Let's cut a deal. I'll buy it, but give me a discount and put a little sign across the thing. And now you can tell people, hey, take a look over there. And that's when I said, well, I've got to take a picture before, and then they're going to be able to see the after. So I literally did that, went back in that neighborhood, and I got 18 homes that signed up, because right there, that's my sister. That's right. You can see it. And they would drive by it. They'd call me, or they just, some people could see it from their front door when I was out talking to them. So it was credibility that, okay, it's cost $100, but is this guy going to do a good job? Right. So make a long story short, I kind of learned it myself, but magical transformation became one of the steps of creating a perfect pitch, which is something that I pride myself in now, is that I'm the guy from Shark Tank that was taking lots of pitches, but I did that for dozens of years before Shark Tank, because I've been in the scene and TV business since the early 80s.
And let me stop you there. Let me stop you, because there's so much we're going to peel back here, Kevin. It's so exciting. Fantastic. So, look, you figured out there's social proof, community proof. You realized how to use it, how to leverage it. And from that, then you moved to a situation where you were doing an HVAC, because in your mind, you said not cyclical sales, but annual revenue coming around, what would work. So now you have this business. Now you leave college. So do you sell the business? I mean, what's the next big step for you?
Yeah, so we were selling way more jobs than we could install, okay? Now, think about that. It's like, if I'm on TV selling a Tony Little product, we can deliver as many as we can sell, right? But when it comes to installing heat pumps and furnaces and air conditioning systems, it's a very specialized installation. I couldn't get enough great installers. This was the beginning of my beginning to not like the business, okay? Because I'd go out, I'd sell 5-6 deals, then I go back and I had some employees and we had to contract out overflow, and my guys were telling me, Kevin, you have to stop selling. We have no more capability. The contractors are already 4 weeks out on what we've got. There's no qualified people. There's no schools that people are coming out of. And I'm like, what's wrong with this picture? I mean, I can sell them, but I can't install them. And I'm like, I'm going to get out of this business. So guess who bought the company? One of my employees, because they saw how amazing what we were doing was. But the guy that bought it had a little bit of an installation background. So he felt, hey, look, Kevin's created the selling team. He's the installation team. Let's do this deal. He bought the company from me. So now I had capital. I was a young entrepreneur. And my job then was finding my next business.
What was that?
Yeah. So, I started checking out all, I was going to all these franchise trade shows. You know, you walk the show, there's, you know, you can buy a maid service, you can buy a restaurant, you can buy an import-export business, whatever. There's, you know, biz ops. I was reading magazines, Entrepreneur Magazine, Inc. Magazine, franchise shows. And what happened was this. So I ended up also sitting with I'll never forget, I sat with a business broker, and I didn't need the broker to sell my business because I sold it to one of my employees. But now I had a pile of cash and I'm sitting there and I said, hey, I want to buy a business. He says, what do you want? I said, what do you got? And he had 200 businesses for sale, stacks of businesses for sale on his desk. And he, okay, we've got this one. This is a laundromat. No, you don't need any labor. It's all cash. You just got to get the location, bop, bop, bop. But it's very small cash flows, right? Then, oh, you're going to own a restaurant. And as I looked at all these, one of the ones I was looking at the time was called California Closet Company. Have you ever heard of that company?
Of course.
They do amazing, what? Magical transformations inside your closet. So I went out and met the owner of this company, and we get talking. He's like, he says, Kevin, you're interested in buying a franchise? I said, well, I don't know what I'm interested in, but I love what you're doing. Maybe there's something that I can do to get involved with you because I sold my heating and air business because of the labor. This is a very labor-oriented business. I don't know that I'm going to love this, but he's like, hey, look, I'll tell you what. We were just featured in Entrepreneur Magazine. I got about 100 leads from the East Coast. This guy lived in Los Angeles. He said, why don't you work the East Coast leads, and I'll pay you a commission if you sell any until you find a business to be in.
So now, How old are you?
This was in 1980. Okay, so that is what, 40 years ago. I was 23 years, I'm 63. So it was 40 years ago. And so so now I'm representing California Closets. And so I'm meeting with these people. They want to buy a business just like I did. I was still searching for a business, but I'm representing this. Well, the people are like, look, I don't want that. What else do you got? And I'm like, well, I don't have anything else. Well, maybe I need to go get something else. So then I became a business and franchise broker because one of the most powerful things I mentioned, I'm sitting there with this broker. What did he have? Stacks of businesses for sale, but he had the books and records of every one of the companies he was selling. Because it's just like if you're selling a piece of real estate, you got to know the square footage, the air conditioning systems, the this, the that, the electrical. You're selling a business, you got to know all that, plus the sales and the losses or the gains or the profits or the historical data. So I found this was better than a college education, immersing myself in 200 financial statements and understanding the trends and the flows and where the business was going. So I became a business broker, and it was purely to see the opportunities in the marketplace, but I started investing in the businesses. I'd see a guy wanted to sell. Why? Well, I need some capital. How much you need? Well, I need 20 grand. Well, let me give you the 20. I'll take some equity. And now we're partners. So it was I started being a shark back in 1980 because I owned equity in a dozen companies way back. And it gave me the chance to really understand the inner workings of many different types of businesses. And so here I am running this business brokerage, and we're selling franchises and business pizza parlors, laundromats, flower shops, delicatessens, you name it. But I tell you what, I was becoming very smart, very fast on many different industries. And so one day I'm successful. I bought a new house. I order cable TV. I'll never forget. I go home and the cable just got installed. Back in the early 80s, when cable first hit, there was 30 channels, 30. And so I'm going through all the channels. I get through CNN, 24 hours of news, MTV, 24 hours of music, HBO, movies. And boom, I'm like, wow, I get to the last channel. It's channel 30. There's nothing there. It was supposed to be the Discovery Channel. So I called the cable company. I said, hey, you guys are gone. They installed this earlier today. I love cable. I love the 29 channels I'm getting, but I'm paying for 30. I'm not getting anything on the last channel. They said, oh, Discovery is our last channel. Just came together. They don't have any money. They only do 18 hours a day. And I said, what do you mean they do 18 hours a day? I said, well, 6 hours a day is nothing. Okay. I was like bars on the screen. So I said, well, if I had something to put on there, could we do some business? They said, sure, come on down. So it's just crazy how things happen. And so here I am selling businesses, doing trade shows. And I'm at the, you know, because I'm selling flower shops, I'm at the flower show. Restaurants, I'm at the restaurant show. Home and garden store, I'm at the home show. Philadelphia home show, I'm watching. I'm walking through the show and I see a guy, he's got a knife in his hand. He's cutting through a Coca-Cola can, through a muffler, through a pair of sneakers. He says, it's called the Ginsu knife. And his name was Arnold Morris. I saw him sell thousands of dollars of Ginsu knives back in the early 80s. And what did my head say? Yeah, I'm going to buy a set. But secondly, I'm going to film that pitch and take it over to Discovery Channel and cut a deal because they need, this guy is selling one-on-one, one him to 5 people at a time, 10 people at a time, whatever. What if I could get him on Discovery and be in front of millions of people? And that's what I did. I shook hands with Arnold Morris to be a partner. We launched it on Discovery Channel and it took off. It was unbelievable what happened from there because I had up to 6 hours a day, but I only had one product. So now I call Arnold and I said, Arnold, it's a home run. We're making big money. You're going to be a millionaire. Go find me any product you can that has a demonstration like you. He said, well, Mike, you're going to cut me in on the deals? I said, absolutely. He brought me Billy Mays, Wally Nash, Sandy Mason, all these people, some of which you may or may not know, but hopefully you remember the name Billy Mays, the guy with the beard, right? Mm-hmm. And so we started doing infomercial after infomercial. I mean, we were dozens, then hundreds, and we went public on the New York Stock Exchange. We grew to $500 million in sales, and the stock went from $1 a share to $20 a share, okay? So I'm like, this is Americana, right? I mean, nowhere else but America can I start from zero and build a $500 million business. I mean, the value of the company on the public market was $575 million. Started from
Kevin, zero. Kevin, it's incredible. Let me stop you there. I want you to take a break. We'll be right back. We're going to talk about, Kevin used the word earlier. Kevin has so many talents, but the one talent I really want to talk about, you said it earlier, is the pitch. So when we come back to the Mossimer Show, we're going to talk about the pitch. Hey everybody, it's Rod Santomassimo with the Mossimo Show, back with the, this is the correct word, incomparable Kevin Harrington, who, by the way, is the success catalyst. Okay, Kevin, let's get back into it. Amazing career, but look, we all have unique abilities. You have several unique abilities. I read several of your books, but one of the books was called The Key Person of Influence. You mentioned these 5 P's. You talked about one, the 5 keys, by the way, were pitching, publishing, product, profile, and partnerships. We can't get to them all, but we can get to at least some of the key ones. First one, obviously you're a pitch man. So to the audience out there, let's talk about what does it take for a great pitch?
Right. So the Key Person of Influence book is powerful because it talks about how you, in whatever industry you're in, can become the most talked about person. If you're in real estate, you're going to get all the good listings, et cetera. How do you do that? You have to set a path and a plan. And that's what we teach you in the book, is how to create a plan to become that key person of influence. And so you have to have a great pitch. And when you're pitching, I've taken now, in the last 40 years, over 50,000 pitches. Now, 50,000 sounds like a lot, but 40 years is a long time to be able to take them. But I will tell you about 30,000 of those have been in the last 5 years, okay? Because it's been very, very, very aggressive lately. And I'm going to give you three steps to a perfect pitch. Very simple. Tease them, please them, seize them. Tease, please, seize. You tease with an attention-getting problem. So you're going to pitch somebody. You got to identify a problem, get their attention, designating that problem. That's the tease. The please is now solving the problem with magical transformations and testimonials and demonstrations. And so now you've got their attention with a problem. You've solved the problem with magical transformations, and they're probably now wanting it because you've got their real attention and their excitement about it. But now the most important thing is seize, and that is close with an irresistible offer. Because on Shark Tank, I want $1 million for 5% of my company. Now, okay, now you may get my attention. You may be a great problem. You may solve the problem, but that's not an irresistible offer. So yeah, there's no deal. So you literally need to be able to tease, please, seize. That's pitching. Now, if we go down the five P's, pitching is one. Partnerships, well, let me talk about profile, raising your profile. And that's very important. How do you raise your profile? Well, the publishing is another one of the P's, and that's also part of raising your profile. You want to write books. And I'm going to be talking about my new book coming out here in just a minute, but you need to create content, write books, produce videos, get out in the world, speak at events, all the things that you and I have been doing for years now, Rod, is getting out, connecting, communicating, shooting videos, etc. So we teach you how to pitch, we teach you how to raise your profile, we teach you how to create amazing partnerships, right? So partnerships was another one, and that's kind of says what it is. I mean, when I moved here to St. Pete, Florida in 1994, I formed a partnership with Home Shopping Network. And I was the CEO of Home Shopping Network Direct. And we were 50-50, and I had access to all their infrastructure, their shipping, their fulfillment, all the many great things they had there. It was an amazing partnership. When I was doing a mobile app, I formed an amazing partnership with Sprint. And they put my mobile app on 6 million phones. Think about that. I mean, what kind of partner is better than Sprint if you've got a mobile app, right? Walked right into Sprint, pitched the CEO of the company, Marcelo Klar, and he stood up and said, we're gonna do it, and we did. And so you need great partnerships, you need to productize your business, that's the product side. And I think we got pitching, profiling, partnerships, productizing, and
publishing, you said it all, yep.
And which one?
Publishing, you said it.
Publishing was writing books and creating content. So we got it. Those are the five P's.
And for you, it seems like you have so many talents, but you said it yourself, that your ability to find partnerships and then leverage those, whether it be Arthur with the Ginzu Knives and taking it to the Discovery and three parties, perfect fit, next thing you know, boom, Sprint, you, app, boom. People, you know, today you can create content. We know that you should, you could. Your pitch, agreed, is probably the most, because you can't do the pitch, it doesn't matter. Everything else just doesn't matter.
You gotta have a pitch. You won't even get on Shark Tank if you don't have a pitch, right? So they don't even give you a chance to
solve. Okay, Kevin, I'm gonna take you way back. Way back. This is a true story. Way back, I invented a watch that tracked workouts, okay? I did. I'm an inventor. And one day I got a letter at my house from Shark Tank. This is true. Said, hey, we want you to pitch your wares on our show. I was flabbergasted. I was. Probably the years you were there, because it was really early. My pitch sucked. Yeah. So I didn't get on.
Hey, it's there. Like I said, there is a, you know, there's a, and I gave you the three steps of pitching, tease, please, seize. There's a 12-step formula that I've created, and so that's pretty cool. But the tease, please, seize is sort of a summary of all 12 steps.
Yeah, and I highly recommend the book, Key Person of Influence. You got to read that key. Let's talk about Key Person of Influence. Let's go with Zig Ziglar. How's he fit in your journey?
Zig, amazing guy. They broke the mold when they made Zig Ziglar. I've watched him for years, speaking, all of his, all the stages he was on. I followed him. And there's a guy that created a lot of content in person, Automobile University. I listened to tapes. I bought videos. I've hung with Zig and watched him at the events. He became a mentor to me. And it was just very, very powerful to be able to have somebody like a Zig Ziglar as a teacher in my life. And so, I mean, Zig was, just to show you the power that he had, he never did social media because he was in his 80s when he passed, and he passed about 8 years ago. So, you know, Facebook and all that wasn't really hot back then. And so when he died, the family decided to put up a Facebook page for people to be able to leave a tribute, right? 4.9 million people are now following the deceased Zig Ziglar on Facebook. And I mean, think about that. That's pretty doggone amazing. Think how many followers he would have if he was alive today doing what he does, what he did, right? I mean, the guy was just an unbelievable force. And I actually cut a deal with the family to relaunch a lot of his products. And so I have, you know, a couple different little things here I can show you. But this is one of the other books. We relaunched the Zig Ziglar Secrets of Closing the Sale with Kevin Harrington. And I've got 18 mini chapters in this book now. So I believe that Zig's message needed to come back and be put forth to all of the younger community today. I've got two kids, one's 32, one's 22. They both are Zig Ziglar fans in a big, big way. So I think it's powerful and important to
okay, get so, guys
like Zig and bring them back.
Yeah, we had the honor of having his son, Tom, on our show, and incredible. Tom and I had so much in common, it was kind of scary. But yeah. Let me ask you, Zig was a mentor.
He wrote the, by the way,
what about mentors?
Who wrote the foreword in my book? Tom Ziglar, okay?
Ah, look at that. It comes full circle. Yeah. Let's talk about Mentor to Millions. What's the objective? What's the scope? What's the takeaway from this new book, this new project you have?
So people will a lot of times, I'm running through an airport and some guy come running all the way across and grab me. Hey, Kevin Harrington, I see you on Shark Tank. I got one quick question. I'm a college graduate and I'm looking to do something. Give me one piece of advice if I'm starting my own business right now. And so I get that all the time. That's, you know, and this is what I say. I say, when I was a young entrepreneur, I had a chip on my shoulder. I was egotistical, thought I could do everything myself. You know, I don't know what it was, but I was the salesman. I did the installations of the driveway ceiling, as I mentioned. I was a full turnkey guy that did it all. And as I tried to grow, you can't do everything if you're going to grow. So I was too cheap to want to buy and hire the right kind of people. And finally, one day I figured it out. And this is what happened. I got into that infomercial business. I had the Ginsu going like crazy. I needed capital for inventory. I went to 5 banks and got turned down. And by all of them, because I was a young company. We didn't have any real assets other than the inventory, and they didn't want to own knife sets if I didn't pay the loan back. So finally, through a connection and an organization, I found a retired banker who was a former president of a bank. He joined my dream team as I started creating, and this is where I'm going with all of this. Entrepreneurs today need to create a dream team that consists of coaches and advisors and mentors. And that's why I wrote the book Mentor to Millions. I'm one of the co-founders of the Entrepreneurs Organization. We've got hundreds of thousands of people that have been involved with that for years. We mentor them. Every entrepreneur gets an advisory board and a mentorship board when they join an organization like EO. I'm mentoring dozens and dozens of companies now. I sit on about 7 or 8 public board of directors. That's a mentoring kind of a thing. So, I mean, this is a book about how to get a mentor, why you need a mentor, and what a mentor can do for you in your business life. So, a very powerful thing. Once I learned how to bring mentors into my life, my business 10x'd very quickly. The guy that I hired to get me financing, he got us a $3 million line of credit, and we ended up quadrupling the size of the company with that line of credit. So you got to get people that are smarter than you in the areas that you don't have the strengths in.
Oh, amen. So true. So Kevin, entrepreneurs are listening to this. They're saying, okay, got the secret sauce. I need a mentor, need a coach. How do I get more of you? I want more of Kevin. How do I get more of you?
Well, you know, I create books, I've created videos, I do events. Right now, obviously with COVID, things are a little quiet on the event side. Last year I was on the road 200 days. I pretty much have been for 4 months outside of one trip, been locked and loaded, so at home. And so I think things will start loosening up, you know, as things are going here, but big events like you used to see. I mean, do you remember the event Zig used to speak at with, you know, 10, 15, 20,000 people? You're just not going to see that kind of thing happening until next year, probably. So, but for me, if people want to get in touch with me, I can leave some ways to do that, or through you, they can get in touch with me. But I still mentor entrepreneurs. I coach entrepreneurs, and my business model has changed a little bit. I still have products on TV, but I take equity in companies. I invest, or I join the boards, I become an advisor, a mentor, and I'm looking for a few key deals on an annual basis to add to the list that I'm involved with now. But I mean, just to give you an example, I'm involved with a little teeny company called Celsius, and it's an energy drink. The company I got involved with back 5 years ago, the company had a value of about $5 million at the time. We just tipped $950 million in value yesterday. Okay. So from 5 million to 950, it's a $1 billion business almost. Started with a couple million bucks. Okay. So, I mean, a couple million dollars in value. It started with even less. So, I mean, this is what I love to do, is get involved with companies that have great opportunity to grow. And then I pitch in and help out along the way.
Amazing. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Kevin Harrington, we're blessed to have you on our show today. Thank you so much for your time.
You bet. I love being here, Rod. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, everyone, you know what we always say, you got a lot of information from Kevin today. So now you have knowledge. So what? Knowing isn't doing. Don't kid yourself. Go out there and create the business and life you've always desired. Take care.